This is episode 43 of the Reading Cove's podcast. If you're a book lover who may be interested in joining our online book club, please visit our website at thereadingcove.com. For June 2014, we're discussing The Rosie Project by Graeme Simsion. So hi, I'm Millenia in Florida.
I'm Roberta in Georgia.
And I'm Cheryl in Arizona.
And we three are members of the Reading Cove, and we're here today to discuss our 163rd pick, The Rosie Project, by Graeme Simsion. And this was chosen by Cove member Marianne.
Yeah.
I think Marianne's in Kansas. So what did we think of The Rosie Project? Tell me how much you love Dawn.
Oh, I love them a lot.
I know.
Well, we were talking again about TV shows, but all I could think about was Sheldon from The Big Bang Theory.
Yeah, that's what everybody was saying.
He's very intelligent. He's very methodical. Mm-hmm. He's very goal-oriented and task-oriented and very orderly.
Right.
And I just loved him to death. And the curveballs were thrown at him really disturbed him. And it just cracked me up to see him trying to fit into society.
I liked it, too. I liked Don because I said now there's more of this diagnosis of Asperger's. But they said somewhere in the book early on that a lot of people who have Asperger's don't really know it, you know, unless they they have a worse, you know, spectrum on the autism spectrum. But if they're really highly functioning Asperger's, they may not know it. People just think they're different. Like our earlier book, The Kitchen Daughter.
Right.
She just thought that was how her personality was. But I know Don thought he was different and he didn't do well. But there's lots of people like that out there, really, whether they're truly Asperger's syndrome or not. But, you know, I liked him. And one of my favorite lines early on in the book, when he's trying to explain what he does, that he says, "I spend most of my working day trying to get mice drunk."
That was funny.
Yes, you know, there's this guy that don't think he really has much of a sense of humor. And maybe he didn't mean to make it humorous. He was just telling it like, you know, he saw it. But
right.
And I tried to tell my husband, he said, "I don't think that's funny." And I said, "Well, you know, I do. So you're not..." So sometimes I think I have a twisted sense of humor. But, you know, I thought it was funny because to think of that's your life work. Trying to, you know, get a mouse drunk.
Well, yeah, I thought it was funny in the context that he was saying it, like what he said before when he explained what he does.
Right.
And then he, you know, framed it in that way and said, you know, that's what I do all day. I try to get mice drunk.
Yeah.
Because I'm doing tests, you know.
Yeah, it's really, you know, a brilliant guy and can do all these neat things and understands these things that make many people's brains just explode. So.
Yeah, I thought it was interesting that to me, it was very obvious, and I think to anybody, that he was not normal. But he just seemed to think nothing of it. It's like he didn't know he had this Asperger's or whatever. But his friend, they knew, Gina and his wife, Claudia, they knew. And, you know, it was interesting to see how they tried to manage him or they tried to guide him, you know, in different ways, because, you know, they were aware of it, but he clearly was clueless about it.
Well, it was a giveaway when Gene asked him to do the conversation or the instruction on class of Asperger's.
Mm-hmm.
Very, exactly. Very beginning. So that's where you got the clue.
Yeah. And then what's his name? I think his wife might have said, "Remind you of anybody?" You know, when he was like rattling off all the characteristics of Asperger's and in the range and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And she asked him, "Remind you of anybody, Don?" Sound like anybody, you know?
He had no clue, you know? Well, he didn't understand sarcasm when he met Rosie. Mm-hmm. And he didn't understand a lot of conventional things, just being polite and being in a group.
Yeah, the funniest part to me was when he goes to the restaurant and they tell him his jacket, you know, he's underdressed, his jacket's not.
Oh, yeah.
I was cracking up.
My jacket is much nicer than that one.
Yeah, and he pins the guy down and it was just crazy.
It was sort of like with Jack Nicholson and As Good As It Gets, you know.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, yeah, type of issue that it still is like they can't understand why these people are being so particular about jackets.
Right. But outside of that, it wasn't my cup of tea. He got on my nerves pretty quickly. His quirks were just annoying to me. I don't typically enjoy that kind of quirkiness. And I got really bored with Don after a while. I thought it was well written. And the other thing that bugged me, I didn't feel like Rosie, the character of Rosie, I see what was supposed to, what you're supposed to get from their relationship. But I just didn't feel her character was that developed enough to explain how she would fall in love with him. I just felt like that was forced, or that was, you know, you're supposed to just take that for granted, but I didn't see it happen. I don't understand why someone of her, you know, why she would have fallen in love with him. What do you guys think about that?
Well, I think even though, as you said, he's quirky and I'm different. I like quirky a lot, especially mm-hmm. books. I love books with quirky characters. But I think that she saw him as someone who was, as you said, he was like he had his habits. He was dependable, that he kept things organized. He just didn't live in this big chaos. And even though he wasn't very emotional, and she even accused him of not being able to love, that he didn't get all these big emotional things that, like the quote, you know, typical male would, that so he didn't have all this high drama going on, you know, around him. And she knew that he wasn't going to be running around, you know, like their friend Jean. So I think there was something about him, even though he was different from the, you know, regular type guy she'd come in contact with. And he was, you know, he was very nice to her. He was willing to do a lot of different things for her that someone else, especially someone who hadn't known her a long time, would even think about doing, you know, especially like for her father project. Everything was a project with him. So about her father project, he went above and beyond what anybody else would have done and even put his job at risk, you know,
right
it there. So, you know, I think she could, you know, first admire him, even though he was kind of quirky and didn't have this emotional depth. And then she could see, you know, his good side. And he would be one of these people, once he finally did make a commitment, you wouldn't have to worry about him going astray.
Well, I thought it was interesting how they met, because Jean and Claudia set him up with her. Or Jean mm-hmm. did. Maybe Jean saw that in her because he knew her for so long and everything, and thought that she would attract Don, she would be attracted to Don, and maybe look for some more stability in her life because she had so many different issues, and maybe Don would help her with that. I think that was a good matchup. It took a lot of talking to Claudia for Don to realize that he was in love with Rosie.
Yeah, but I think that was really the only connection for me, was the fact that it was a setup by Jean. Like, it was orchestrated by him, knowing that there would be some kind of connection between them. But I didn't get it myself from her character.
You think she would understand a little bit more about Don since she, you know, had her all this education in psychology? You know, but at the same time, I guess even if you know about certain things, it doesn't always make you comfortable with somebody who has these other, you know, issues and quirks and everything. But with his crazy questionnaire, you know, saying at first, it's totally unsuitable, especially it was like the cigarette smoking was the deal breaker to him. But then like, okay, well, so I thought that was funny to set up your questionnaire. But there's probably people out there that, you know, do that. I thought that, I can't even remember, was it one date they set up Don with, but it was the apricot ice cream woman.
Yes.
She has some issues, you know, so fixated on one thing that you can't do it, you know, you just have to, you know, have what you want or not, then to me, that's a lot worse than having to deal with someone who has Asperger's. You know, you're very inflexible, so I don't think I'd want to be around someone like that. So that was definitely a bad blind date for poor Don.
I don't know. I think she was probably reacting to him because it's fine, you know, in a theatrical form like this book. But in reality, how does someone like him play? You know, I mean, really, how would somebody react to him? I mean, he's very strange.
Right.
I can't imagine enjoying being around someone like that unless, you know, he's your family and you know him beyond just, you know, social interaction or meeting them on the job or something, you'd be looking at him cross-eyed, like, this guy is crazy.
Or like,
he's weird. Well, he's not crazy, but he's definitely weird.
Apricot Woman was very inflexible, as well as Don.
Yeah, exactly.
So, I mean,
I think she was reacting to him, though. She wasn't enjoying the date. That's the kind of what I got from it. It was like she was being a jerk to him because she just didn't like it. She was, you know, she wanted the date to be over. Like, I don't want ice cream with you, okay? If I can't get this ice cream, I don't want any ice cream.
Who's to say she didn't have Asperger's?
So what did you think? What did you all think about Don? It just seemed like he'd sort of left his family behind. They weren't totally estranged, but, you know, they... Do you think maybe his sister dying, that kind of put things, you know, bad between him, or that they just, you know, couldn't connect with him either?
Her sister was his best friend, and she understood him and everything, but she died so tragically, you know, with an ectopic pregnancy, I think it was, and she was single. And she blamed, he blamed the medical field. I think, yes, definitely, that his family was just, you know, his weekly call to his mother. He didn't have nothing in common with his brother or his father. So he would just talk to her once a week, and that was that.
Yeah, I don't remember a sense of his family being a presence in the story.
They weren't.
Much of a presence, yeah.
He talked more about his sister a couple of times, but I remember they did have one conversation with his mother, and I think he referred one time to that, you know, he had no desire to work in the hardware store with his dad or his brother.
The other part that was funny to me was, where he was going to give that lecture in Jean's place or something, and and the woman that was there, what happened? It didn't start on time, and he was like freaking out because, you know, his whole schedule was going to be thrown off. And
dinner was going to be thrown off, and his bedtime, and he's going to have to make up for his shopping in the morning and get up
and
earlier.
He managed to cram the lecture down enough, or they stopped it in time so that he regained the time that he had lost or something.
Right, and then because they were all Asperger's parents there with their children, that he caused that little kind of like riot where they were yelling, Aspie's rule.
I loved when he made that point about, you know, you're hiding from murders or something, and the baby's crying. What do you do? And you haven't come. What do you do?
I thought it was fun when they went to New York. Rosie accepted going to New York, but the first two or three days was hers.
Right.
You know, and Don had to abide by that. Mm-hmm. And that really, you know, put a couple of wrenches. But when he got back to Australia and everything, I thought it was really cute that when he thought about all of his, you know, happiest moments and his happiest days, those three with Rosie were his happiest.
Right.
And that's when he started realizing, you know, how much he missed her and how much he wanted to be around her.
So Rosie was the antidote to his inability to feel emotion.
Right,
That's basically it. She cured him in a way.
And she also took him off his beaten track, you know, took him out of his norm of, you know, being at the Museum of Natural History every day, taking him to Katz's Deli, taking him to the Battery and sightseeing and all that stuff. Those were all brand new experiences to him. And to share it with somebody like Rosie was really darling to him. You know, it took him so long to realize it that it was just so sweet at the end when he finally got back together with her. So, Roberta, would you read the next book that's coming out? Because I've been on Amazon already, and I know it's being released in September, but it's not released for us yet. I definitely want to read the sequel.
Yeah.
I think it would be a lot of fun to see how they handle having a baby. See Don, you know, being frazzled by a crying baby, I think would be hysterical. I think Sally just loved it to death. The fact that the author lives there and everything, she's looking forward to the next book as well, and she can't wait till it comes out.
Yeah, Sally's our member down under.
Yes.
Resident Australian Cove member. But as far as everyone else, I think the majority of us enjoyed it. Most people seem to have given it a B, B plus. I've seen B's. I think there's just like a few of us who, you know, gave it a C or less.
Yeah,
but, so it's a hit.
Tammy and Kim are struggling with it, and well, Tammy didn't like it at all, and she thought she was the only one that did. Kim was struggling to get through with it.
Right, and I think Robin said she was struggling with it. I don't think Nicole liked it much. I think she gave it a C. I gave it like a C minus.
Yeah, I think I am giving it an A just because of the quirkiness. And I've also known Asperger's people, and I've also researched and read a lot about Asperger's.
Right.
In fact, we're reading
a lot of Asperger's stuff lately. You notice that? It's like, what's up with commercial fiction and the Asperger's syndrome nowadays?
Yeah, exactly. Well, Jodi Picoult did it with an Asperger's kid who was like 14.
That may have been what started this trend.
Yes. You know, if everybody listens to the podcast and everything, look up Asperger's. It's a very broad spectrum from very low functioning to very high functioning.
Right.
But most of the people are like Don. And it's just a fascinating topic if you're into psychology and everything. To see how Asperger's do fit in.
Right. All right. So that is going to be our discussion of The Rosie Project by Graeme Simsion. And thank you to our listeners for tuning in. As always, continue to leave us your comments below. And stay tuned for our next episode where we'll be discussing Blink of an Eye by Ted Dekker, which I think is a thriller or something. So looking forward to that change of pace. See you next time. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.